seeds in good soil. To receive your word this morning, anoint me to preach, to teach with your wisdom and become more perspective, Lord. Sometimes we read things in the Bible that may be very challenging for us to do in our heart, but we need to see things from your perspective. So help us with that this morning. In Jesus, it's in your name again we pray.
Amen.
So last week we talked about the benefit of giving, and I said we're going to continue for this month talking about giving. And I think maybe we were all here except maybe Brenda, I think. She wasn't here last week. But last week we talked about the benefit of giving. We talked about giving God what is His, the tithe, and the offering. And if we weren't doing that, you know, we each have an area of growth, you know. And we're going to talk about that a little bit as we start this morning. But, you know, if you felt touched last week, what do you do? You just repent and change and say, Lord, I want to start now. I'm going to start from now on giving you my Lord. We talk also about trusting God and using the opportunity of giving to show God, hey, I trust you to take care of me. I trust you to provide for me, like we just sang about. And that it will help us as we give, keeps our love growing. It helps us to be compassionate to other people. So today we're going to talk about, again, about the subject of giving. And we're going to talk about from the perspective of having a lifestyle, that it becomes like a habit for us to give, that it won't be like a struggle every time we feel touched or every time there's an opportunity to give, we don't feel like, or this big struggle between, oh, I can't afford it, or I don't know what God wants me to do, or should I give or not give? And we have maybe this internal struggle. What we want to do is we want to develop just a lifestyle. This becomes a habit where, you know, when God touches our heart, touches our spirit, we think, oh, fine, I'll give. And the struggle is over. Maybe some of you last week really struggled with that. That's all right. That's a sign that at least you're trying to grow. If last week you just sat there and you just dismissed it, you know, then that's actually worse. If you're struggling, you know, at least you're making the step where you're thinking about it. You know that God has touched your heart. What we want to do that is move past that to develop this habit, this lifestyle that just gives. It gives when the Lord tells us to. But first, before we do that, I felt like we should heed the warning that's given in Luke chapter 18, verses 9 through 14. Oh, I love more today. Luke 18, verses 9 through 14. And this is Jesus telling the story. It says, to some who are confident in their own righteousness and look down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray. One a Pharisee, so that's the religious teacher. Knows the law, follows God's law. And the other one is a tax collector. Ooh, people don't like him, right? Often he maybe cheats people from their taxes. So this one has a higher position in society than him. He's looked down on. And the Pharisee stood by himself and he prayed, God, thank you that I'm not like other people, robbers and evildoers and adulterers. Oh, even him, that tax collector. Oh, I'm glad I'm not like him. He says, I fast twice a week, and I give a tenth of all I have. But the tax collector, he stood at a distance. He wouldn't even look to heaven. His head was down. And it says, he beat his breast. He said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And Jesus says about those two, he says, I tell you, this man, rather than the other, he went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. So God says, the tax collector, because he was humble and he cried out for God's mercy, that God has mercy on him. When we depend on our own self-righteousness, that's all we have left. That's all we have left. We say, I'm more righteous than you. So even in the area of giving, maybe that's not your area of growth. Maybe you're fine with giving. But yeah, I tithe, I give offerings, I give, I support charity. Be careful that it doesn't become an area where you like boast and start to look down at other people, because that can easily turn into self-righteousness. So we need to be careful with that this morning as we begin. So be careful, you know, we need to stay humble, because even if giving is not an area where you feel like you need a lot of growth, and for most of us, it probably is an area where you need a lot, but even if you feel like it's not, I am sure you have other areas in your life that you need to grow in, and you need to be humble before God about. And like Jesus said, if you get big-headed and you exalt yourself, God's going to put you down in your place. He's going to humble you. He'll force you to be humble. But if you yourself, you choose to be like him, you humble yourself before God and say, I know there are areas in my life I need to improve. I know there are still places I'm growing in. I'm not yet perfect. Then God has mercy on me. And then he decides when the time is right to lift us up. If we look at Paul's attitude, in Philippians chapter 3, verse 12, he's talking about knowing Christ. He's talking about his own spiritual growth. He says, I have not already obtained all this. I haven't succeeded where I want to be in my spiritual relationship with God. I haven't succeeded yet. He said, I haven't arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. So he has this goal. He wants to grow spiritually. He wants to know Christ more. But he says he hasn't arrived. He hasn't achieved it all yet. So even Paul, he says, after this, he says, you know, he has to put all the things in the past behind him. And he sets his eyes on Jesus and on that race and the goal. He presses on. So we need to have that same attitude. Well, I haven't arrived yet. I have nothing in me to be proud of. I have nothing in me. I can't depend on my own righteousness and what I think I need. Good, and to stay humble before God and ask him to keep working in my life. Ask him to help me carry on to the goals and the plans that he has for me. So, you know, if you felt last week, oh, I felt that was so challenging, like a big struggle, don't feel like it was a negative thing. That's God challenging you. That's God encouraging you to grow. You know, some of you maybe you have been coming to the church a long time, many, many years. And maybe you've never given any kind. Maybe you've never even given a dollar to the church, to some work of ministry. Now God is challenging you because he wants you to grow. Maybe some of you have been coming many, many years, and you feel stuck in your growth. Sometimes we're stuck in our growth because we're not listening. We're not paying attention to what God, when he challenges us, when he tells us to do something new. So I encourage you, continue to grow. Don't feel discouraged or upset. Oh, like I said, just repent and say, okay, Lord, now on, I want to start growing in that area. I want to see improvements in my life. I want it to become a lifestyle and a habit and not a struggle. And just begin where you are. See, pick up on all the years I missed the time. Just start where you are. Start now with repentance and with faithfulness to him, and God will honor you. Just like this verse says, we humble ourselves before him. He will be the one to lift us up and to exalt us. So we want to take another look at the lifestyle today that cherishes giving and that enjoys giving. And so, since we already talked about money, we're just going to focus on it for the very first point, a little bit about money again. And it's really about every area of our growth, not only about money. But if we want to grow in Christ, it costs something. Now, salvation is free, right? Amen? Salvation, God gives it freely to us when we believe. However, spiritual growth comes at a price. You know, like Pastor Darrell sang about, we talk about surrendering our lives. If we're surrendering something, we're making sacrifices. We're giving things up to grow in Him and to mature. So we want to take a look at counting the cost. What does that mean? And we're gonna read Luke when Jesus is speaking and talking about following Him. You know, when you accept Jesus, when you have that new life begin, now you're called to follow Jesus, to become His disciple, to grow, to mature. And in Luke chapter 14, He says, "Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." So here Jesus is saying, each one of us has a cross to pick up and carry. That cross represents our life that God has called us to as we follow Him. And we have to be willing to pick it up and to be faithful to Him, to follow Him. He says, if you don't want it, you can't be His disciple. He says, what if one of you wants to build a tower? Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? If you lay the foundation and you can't finish, everyone who sees it will ridicule you, saying, this person began to build and could not finish. Okay, so that's the first example, is a man who sits down, he wants to build a tower. How many of you have ever built something or had something built on your house? I know, Eric, your family built like house part, right? But first they sat down and they thought about how much it's going to cost, right? See if we have the money, we can afford to build, right? Because he's saying, you don't want to go ahead and pour the cement and have the foundation and then your money's gone. And now you just have this big concrete slab and you have no house on it. You have no tower on it. And then all your neighbors came. Wow, he poured that concrete, that hard slab. Wow, and then he just left it there for 5 years. And nothing happened after that. I see when I go to Arizona, I see, you know, when the economy was going up and it was good, they started all these projects. Started, and you see like partway, and then you see when the money ran out, when the economy started going bad, because it just stops. They don't finish. They like part of it is built, and then their money has run out.
Then Popeye.
Same where? Popeye. You think the money's run out over there on the corner? She says, yeah. We noticed normally places around here, they get built up fast, and that place seems to be kind of slow in getting going. Maybe they've run out of money. I don't know. That's possible. And then he gives a second example. He says, what if a king is about to go to war against another king? Won't he first sit down and consider if he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other king is still a long way off and will ask for peace. In the same way, those of you who might give up everything you have cannot be my disciples. So following Christ has a price. If you want to grow, it will cost you something. He says we have to be willing to give up everything. And in this example, we see a king who, my army is small, their army is big. Oh, I'm going to send this little group off. You go negotiate peace. We don't want to face them anymore, right? So he says you have to sit down and you have to think about the cost. Same way, you want to grow spiritually, it's going to cost you something. Sit down, think about it, pray about it. Are you willing to give up everything to grow, to follow him? You know, as we develop that lifestyle, we learn to see things from heaven's perspective. And we learn to develop the attitude that we're not tied to earthly things. That even if your house caught fire and burnt down, you could be free of those possessions. That's kind of the goal as we grow. We don't want to be so attached to the earthly things that when we lose them, oh, it just tears us apart. because, oh, that was my favorite, whatever. You know, yeah, there would be things we would miss and it would probably devastate us for a while, but to have that perspective thinking, you know what, I wasn't going to take that with me anyway. I remember a few months ago, there's something I have, and it's just, it's nothing important or bigger, but it's something I liked. And my cats, it's like a little, it's a thing made of paper. It's a little like tag. And my cats knocked over my fish tank, my little fish, on it, and soaked it, and ruined it, and destroyed it. And it's the kind of thing that can't be replaced. And then it was like later, I was like, you know what? I'm not gonna have that forever anyway. You know what? I'm not bringing that to heaven. And then like, oh, okay, fine. I won't be mad at the cats. I did not kill the cats. But you know, yeah. And I was attempting. No, I'm just kidding. But no, I didn't kill the cats. I was mad for a while, but then I was like, there, you know what? We can't bring things with us. We need to learn just to be detached. And like, yeah, maybe at first we get upset, and then we say, no, you know, wait a minute. Let me get my thinking right. Let me get heaven's perspective. Nothing on earth is going to heaven with us, nothing. Except people, right? Our family, our friends, the people we witness to. We're not bringing things with us, so we need to live more simply and let go of earthly possessions. So we're going to look at that in Luke chapter 12. This is when Jesus has been teaching them about, you know, God takes care of the birds and don't worry about all this stuff. And he says, do not set your heart on what you will eat or drink. Do not worry about it, for the pagan world runs after all these things. How many of you know that when Apple made the announcement last week about the new iPad, that there are people, they're ready to line up and buy it, right? They want the next thing, the next, or I want one too, but I'm not going to line up. I'm going to hopefully, if God allows me to save money, maybe in the future, I don't know when, but actually I want the smaller one when they announce it. But anyway, that's off the point. But you know what? The world, people, they want after things, right? They want the next big thing. They want the next technological gadget, the phone or the tablet or the computer or the car or the dress or whatever it is, they want the next thing. He says, they run after all those things, but your Father knows you need them. God knows what you need. If I need an iPad, He'll find a way for me to get one, right? He says, seek His kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. So the things we really need, He will take care of. As long as we're seeking Him, He takes care of us. He gives us the things we need. He says, do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father is pleased to give you the kingdom. He says, what? Your things that you do have, sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourselves that will never wear out. A treasure in heaven that will never fail, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. Where your treasure is, their heart will be also. So instead of chasing all these things on earth and find ourselves being bound to them or being tied to them, let go of them and have the freedom to say, you know what, I don't need maybe to buy that, or I don't need, you know, or maybe I have these things that I'm not using, or I feel like, you know, I just don't need that. Sell it, give the money away to somebody that needs it more than you do. And then, you're storing up things in the future. You know, it talks about, and I don't put this down, but it talks about the Bible, it talks about, you know, that our works in heaven, when they're judged, they're going to be shown for what they are. Are they going to burn up like straw, like hay, just burn up and be gone? Or are they going to be things that last, those heavenly treasures? What if that's all Jesus has to build with? We talk about Jesus building us a home, right, in heaven. What if He's only using the things we've sent up? That's an interesting concept to think about. So we do need to think about that, though. What am I storing away in heaven for the future? You know, maybe God touches you and heals you. Have you ever thought about, you know what? Maybe I'll give my tithe, but now God has blessed me. God touched me and healed me. You know what? I'm going to give above that. I'm going to give an offering. Like the leper that came to Jesus and Jesus touched him. Jesus healed him and Jesus told him, you go, this was a different story than the ten, but Jesus told him, you go to the priest and you offer the gift that Moses commanded. You know, if God blesses you, why not thank him? You know, we talked about the five sacrifices in the Old Testament. Three of them were just to thank God. Three of them were people noticing God's blessing, or, oh, a good harvest this year, or God protected my family this year. I'm going to give him more just to show my thanks. I'm going to give him an offering. So when God blesses you and you notice it in your life, take the time, give him an offering. You know, there are other things we can do. I mean, he says sit down and count the cost. There are things we can do that will help us financially. You can budget. You can save or invest. Pay off if you're in debt. Pay off your debts to help yourself to improve financially so you can feel more free to give. When you're in debt, it's a burden. The Bible says it's a bondage. So we need to be free of that too. If we're in debt, we need to start paying it off and say, look, help me pay off those debts and get those paid off so I can be free and free enough to have that lifestyle that I can give when I see a need. Now, last week we talked about the Pharisees. They had been faithful to tithe, even on the herbs. On all the little things, they gave their tithe. They were faithful. But Jesus said they neglected more important things, and we read in Matthew about that. We're going to read in Luke now, and then we're going to go back to that one verse in Matthew. So we're going to see Luke's perspective about giving things we can't see. You know, I can see what goes in the offering when I help count it. So we can see things that are obvious. But there are things you guys can give that I can't see. Maybe I see it if I know you better, if I see you outside of church and I can see the fruit in your life. But most of the time, I'm not going to be there to see those hidden, invisible things. And we need to be giving those things too, like what? Well, let's go have a look at Luke. Luke chapter 11, verse 37-42. When Jesus had finished speaking, a Pharisee invited him to eat with him. So he went in and reclined at the table. But the Pharisee was surprised when he noticed that Jesus did not first wash his hands before the meal. Then the Lord said to him, now then, you Pharisees, you clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside you are full of greed and wickedness. You foolish people, did not one who made the outside make the inside also? But now, as for what is inside you, be generous to the poor, and everything will be clean for you. Woe to you, Pharisees, because you give God a tenth of your mint, rue, and all other kinds of garden herbs, but you neglect justice and the love of God. You should have practiced the latter without leaving the former undone. So he's saying, do both. So a lifestyle of giving, it's not only money. It can be our spiritual gifts. It can be our time that we're giving away. But notice what he said. Let's go down to the next slide. Luke talks about being generous to the poor. That could be money. It could be clothes. It could be, you know, a blanket. It could be all different kinds of things. He says, don't neglect justice and the love of God. If we go back to Matthew, he talked about a more important part of the law is justice, mercy, and faithfulness. And again, there it said, you do both. You're faithful with tithe, but you also need to pay attention to the things you can't see, the hidden things that you need to be giving away. So these are things you can give people in your family, people at your job, people in the deaf community, your friends, all the things. What can you give them? You can give them justice. When you see something happening that's not fair, do you get involved or do you say, ooh, I don't want to be involved in that? And you know, when you get involved, that the one of the people involved, they might attack you. That's happened to me before. I've seen people and I see, ooh, maybe an argument or something, and I feel like this person, there's something not fair happening. So I try and help resolve it. And I've had the other person, the second person, like, say, oh, you always support them. You know, so yeah, sometimes you might get chewed out, but are you trying to help resolve, are you trying to help there be fairness? You know, that happens a lot with kids. Kids feel like, well, everything's unfair, unfair, unfair. You have to, like, how can I make this fair? How can there be justice? And there's a lot more important situations happening in the world and in society that involves justice. When you see injustice happening, we see it happening in many other countries in the world. I saw recently a report about slavery that still exists in the world. I can't remember what the estimate was. I think it was about, they said there's about 49 million people, it was either 39 or 49 million people still in slavery in the world. Some still in Africa, many in India, and in that part of the world. You know, we maybe can't go over there and make justice and make it right, but we can give and support the people that do, that are involved in ministry in those places and helping set people free. But there's things that show up in our lives that we need to make right. That there needs to be justice that happens, whether it be in our family or at work, or even maybe you're tempted to do something that's unfair. You say, oh no, I want to follow something that's fair. I don't want to take advantage for myself. I want there to be justice. Mercy. Do we have mercy? We show mercy to other people. That's something often we can't see because it happens in our heart. Do we forgive that person? Maybe somebody hurts us. I'm going to wait for you to come back and you say sorry and you beg me to forgive you. I'm waiting. Is that mercy? No, that's not mercy. Mercy says, I forgive you. And I release you from your debt to me. You owe me, you hurt me, whatever. No, I release you. I'm called to show mercy. I'm called to forgive you. Because God will show mercy, I'm going to forgive you. You know, I remember a few years ago, my older sister came up to me and she told me about something that happened over a period of time when we were young that I don't remember. I forgot that. Now, I could have been like, you did what? And I could have asked her questions and I could have gotten upset because it was actually a very serious situation that she told me about. And I could have just chewed her out. She probably deserved it. Okay, but you know what I said? I forgive you. I gave her peace. It's something that had bothered her for years and years and years, and she never confessed me, and she carried that guilt inside her heart. And I didn't know about it, or I would have told her before, you're forgiven. But she finally came up, and she told me, I'm like, it's fine, don't worry about it. God has taken care of it. I forgive you. And I released her guilt. She was able to release from her guilt. And I know other people, I've tried to do that in my life, and sometimes they still feel, they can't do that, and they still feel guilty, and I try and tell them, no, I forgive you, I'm serious, I really do. You know, sometimes people, they're afraid, they think, oh, you're only saying that. No, I'm serious, I forgive you, don't worry about it. Stop feeling guilty, it's done. Okay, so sometimes you need to emphasize with people, no, serious, I'm giving you mercy, I'm forgiving you, it's over. You don't have to bring it up again, you don't have to apologize, because sometimes people, maybe they come up, it's the same thing, situation, it's a, come on, it's okay, remember, I told you I forgave you. Stop feeling guilty, stop feeling bad, okay? So sometimes we have to emphasize, maybe we have to keep giving them mercy and mercy, I forgive you, seriously, I forgive you, okay? And then faithfulness, are we being faithful to the people in our family? Are we faithful at work? Most importantly, are we faithful to God? We can give our faithfulness to God. And I think that must bless God so much. He's given us free will, right? He lets everyone decide. You can decide how much time you want to spend with Him. You can decide how much, you know, how much you want to give Him praise every day or how much you want to read His Word. And we can just go, okay, Lord, I choose you. Above all the other things I could be doing, I choose you. I choose to be faithful to you. I choose to follow you. I choose to take time with you. And I want to bless God.